Hello and welcome to my introduction to virtualization. So I'll start with the very basics. What is virtualization and why do we need it? Let's start with the most important question, why? So imagine that you're a graphical designer and the company had bought a server for you with 3 GHz of CPU power, frequency, 24 GB of RAM, 10 terabytes of storage, and of course peripherals like monitor, mouse, keyboard, whatever. And you install Windows system, Photoshop, maybe some other tools you want. And after a while you realize that actually you are using only 15% of CPU, maybe a third part of your RAM, and a small portion of the hard disk. It may be not a big deal for you. You might be happier that you have so much freedom, your operating system runs perfectly and everything is good. But for your company, it means that theoretically they overpaid for a huge amount of resources that you do not use. If they would be practical, they would be much better using the same money to support other graphical designers working in your infrastructure. But how would it be possible to make them use the hardware that you already bought? Well, without virtualization, it is impossible. It means that they would have to unplug some RAM from your server and install it on another computer. Maybe replace the hard disks or spread them around if possible, or maybe set up hard disk as a shared storage, and then you would have basically some other troubles with clustering and everything. This processor also, they could sell it and buy a cheaper one, but again, this is extra time, extra resources. The most optimal way would be to somehow use the power of one computer to let multiple functions work at the same time. So imagine if all these Windows and all these Photoshops could use a lot of resources at the same time on the same hardware. So how do we achieve the goal of spreading the resources of the single computer between multiple running computers? Well, this is where the concept of virtual machine comes in. So we need to have a virtual machine which will be a part of your computer. And the virtual machine would only have 1 GHz of CPU, 8 GB of RAM, and 1 TB of hard disk space. How is it possible? Well, let's consider that we use those resources from CPU and RAM, and that small space of the whole from HD. How it can be achieved in our understanding from what we already know about physical computers? Well, at first, there must be something that gives us this functionality. Like, it wouldn't exist without this special functionality. So we need a special program called Hypervisor. Hypervisors can be different. It can be type 1 or type 2, depending on how they run. For example, you might have heard about different like virtual disk software. In the past, we used to quite often apply to the help of virtual disk managers like Nero or Alcohol or other virtual disk software. We could take a CD-ROM and burn it to the hard disk and then burn it to the disk again. So theoretically, we have some kind of virtual disk management software we already know about. Now, there are a lot of hypervisors now, Xen, VMware, Hyper-V, Azure, AWS, Amazon Web Services, and all those programs have the same goal: to spread the physical resources of one computer into multiple operating systems. So how do they actually achieve it? So in this case, the virtual machine must have Windows, which only consumes up to 1 GHz of CPU and up to 8 GB of RAM, and it must have a hard disk which only has 1 TB of space. Well, if we make the whole Windows a single process, basically imagine that your Windows is a running program and we put it in a running context of a single running program. The hypervisor simply gives this program only a maximum of 1 GHz of CPU and a maximum of 8 GB of RAM. So theoretically, since it runs on this hardware, it could have used the whole hardware, but hypervisors puts a limit on how much this process can take. So virtual machine, when it runs, it is a process. What about hard disk? Well, it's also a very simple analogy. It's called a virtual disk, and what hypervisor does, it creates a file, which is a part of your hard disk, and this file becomes the usable space for the running program. So it's a file of a program of virtual machine, which is used as a hard disk. So theoretically, it's a file which is block level device. And if you are afraid of terminology, it's a file which contains data inside of it. And I can give you an example of the files you already know to understand this better. Think of a zip file. It is a single file, but inside of zip file, you can have many folders and many files. Think of RAR file. Think of ISO file, like image file of a hard disk that you would burn to the CD, right? This image looks like a single file, but if you open it with a specific program, inside you have many, like you have a different file structure, you have a different file system. And this is what happens here. Hypervisors makes a file which has a different file system inside of it. So it is like a zip file if it makes it easier for you to understand it. And in the end, the virtual machine and its disk is only one of the files and one of the programs running on hypervisor, which means that it can run 10, 20, 100 programs at the same time as long as it has enough physical resources. And this is how elegantly the solution was found. Now, how it works specifically can differ. Different hypervisors had different technologies. For example, VMware uses VMDK disk format with different files for actual data and disk descriptor. It uses its own types of virtual networks, virtual switches. Hyper-V uses different disk format, VHDX, which can even be understood by Windows. It also doesn't use a differential checkpoints. Like there is a lot of technologies behind it. We can get into this with time, but right now I just want you to understand that hypervisor by itself is nothing magical. It is magical in terms of what it can achieve, but it's simply an operating system which allows you to run other operating systems as programs. And as a result, because of the provided interfaces and functionality, you could deploy 10 database servers on the hardware you have, and you could size them up and down as you want. For example, if you suddenly need more resources on one computer but less on another, you don't have to unplug physical hardware and move it to another computer. You could simply change and redistribute the resources in the settings of hypervisor. I'm going to make this video short, so this is going to be all for my first video. And after that, I'll talk with you. Basically, I'll try to explain step by step how it works for the most basic standalone VMware server. And I will show you the basic interface, what you can do. And if by that time I get some people asking questions, I'll incorporate them in my video. Otherwise, we'll go step by step with the most basic configuration steps, and I will show you how it actually runs. And not to take too much of your time, the only thing I would like you to do, if you are really curious about this, check the difference between type 1 and type 2 hypervisors. Thank you for your time, and have a nice day.